Well, you know, last week I talked about third jihad. I just want to say something. You know what? The devil boasts of great and mighty things that he's going to do. But I heard the name of a song this morning that just really fits in right now so amazingly. Our God is bigger than that. Did you know that our God is bigger than the devil? He is. And I don't care what he boasts and what he says he's going to do, our God is bigger than that. Our God is greater, and there is nothing impossible with God. I thought how that Goliath, remember how he would come out every day, morning and evening, and just try to intimidate all the soldiers, all the people there of Israel, intimidate them of what things he was going to do. He was going to destroy them all. He was just going to take them all out. But our God is bigger. Finally, there was someone that had enough faith to believe that. David went out there with his little slingshot, and he ran towards him and told him what he was going to do. And God fulfilled what he said because he knew his God was bigger than that. And we know that no matter what Satan says he's going to do, all we have to do is keep trusting God. And he is going to take care of this matter here in the United States. There might be times when you get discouraged, when you hear the news or hear all the things that are going on right now. But our God is working, and our God is greater than all of the lies and things that Satan can say and all the lies that he's doing. And all the mouths of liars are going to be silenced one of these days. They're going to be silenced, and God is going to secure the righteous. Praise God. Let us pray. God, I thank you, Lord, for your word tonight, Lord God, and for all that you're doing in our lives, Lord God, for the foundation that you're building in your church, Lord. You are building a mighty church, God, that there's going to be this great awakening, Lord, when your church breaks forth, Lord, to do these great things, God, that you have promised in your word, Lord, and we are going to see billions saved before the end comes, Lord. We thank you for all of this in Jesus' holy name. God is doing a mighty thing right now. Sometimes we can't see all the things that are going on around us and all the things that God is doing, but I want you to know that God is always working. He is working all the time. It is so amazing that he can think of every single one of us at the same time, and that all of his thoughts are us, of us, as many as the sands of the seashore, continually. He never sleeps. He is thinking continually, 24/7, all the time, and he is thinking of us. Thinking of us. And the things he thinks of us are all good things. He says, I know the plans I have for you. They're good stuff, good things ahead for all of us. You know, sometimes when I know something that is going to happen for somebody and I'm supposed to keep quiet about it, it's the hardest thing in the world. And I sometimes think it's amazing that God doesn't tell us all the things ahead of time that he's going to do for us to encourage us, because that's our natural tendency to want to tell people things like that. But God is building a foundation in us, and this foundation is a foundation of trust. And a lot of times when you're building a foundation, you can't see all the things that are going on. Other people can't see it, but you know what's going on. So in the last two or three weeks ago, we talked about Joseph and the dream or the favor that God showed him. God showed him great favor, and he wants to show us great favor today. The title of this message is God's Promises and Favor in Our Life. We obtain these promises by faith, and he has great plans for us, and all we have to do is believe him for it. So when God gave him two dreams, it took a long time for these dreams to come to pass. And why do you think that was? It was because Joseph was not prepared yet. He did not have a solid foundation yet. He didn't have a foundation that he would be able to handle the things that God had for him for those dreams to come to pass. And God is building in us. He's preparing us for our future, preparing us for the things that he has for us to do. And we all have a specific thing and a plan that God has for us to do in this life. And your very life might be here for one purpose only. Many times you're here for many purposes, but you might be here for one specific purpose only, and you don't want to miss it. So even though he went through a lot of hardships while he was waiting for God's purposes to be fulfilled, he continued to trust God, and that's what we have to do also. He gives us dreams, and at the same time, they're to be fulfilled, though, at a time later in our life. He gives us dreams, I think, to give us hope because it's encouraging. When we have a dream, we keep remembering that dream and remembering what it was he told us. And then we have to just trust him. And I remember one time he gave me a dream. He gave me something and asked me what it was that I wanted, and I told him. And then all he said was, trust me. And he said it was almost like an audible voice. I will never forget it to this day. He just said, trust me. And that trust just absolutely burned into my heart at that time. And no matter what things happen, there's times when things look like it's impossible. It would never come to pass. But it's getting closer and closer. And I can begin to see daylight. I can begin to see how God is doing it. And it is going to come to pass. He has to build that same foundation in us. And I want to tell you that when God begins to build a foundation, there's a lot of work that goes into it. And the first thing I know, because Bob and I built a house, and we were in Tucson, we were like our own contractors on the house we built. We had a general contractor that oversaw it, told us how to go about it, but we drew our own plans and did a lot of the physical work on it. The first thing that we did that seemed like it took forever, that we were never going to get past, moving dirt. And then I thought about that. I said, God, the first thing you have to do in our lives is move the dirt. You have to get rid of the dirt. So all we did was just seem like move dirt, and we both had full-time jobs. We would come home from work, and Bob would pick up the shovel and he'd start shoveling dirt. I would go in the house, try to fix something for us to eat, and come out and help shovel dirt. And then we had to, after we got dirt moved to where it was supposed to be, then we had to compact that dirt. And we had a big barrel that we filled with water, and we had to roll it back and forth and back and forth. We put a lot of hard work into that. Things that people that had the right equipment and everything could have done it much faster, but we wanted to do it ourselves. First of all, it was going to save us a lot of money. Second of all, we had a mortgage promised already on the house at a very low interest rate and a low amount, and if we could do it within the certain guidelines of that time, then we could do that. Otherwise, we would have to renegotiate, and we wanted to keep that those terms that we had already established. So we worked as many hours as we possibly could. We worked until dark. We got up in the morning before daylight and worked before we went to work. But we were working on the foundation, and it took forever before we ever saw walls come up. And the foundation, you have to put in underground wiring, you have to put in plumbing, then you have to have all of that approved. They have to come out from the city and check everything out and make sure everything is right according to the plans. And we worked all the time, and I'll remember a Sunday morning one time, all of a sudden, we had not dried in the roof yet. We had got the plywood up there and everything, but we still had to put the tar paper on it and everything before the roofing, and also we hadn't dried it in. And I suddenly, around 4 o'clock, heard a rumbling of thunder in the background, and I said, Bob, wake up quick. I said, it's going to rain. We've got to get out there and dry in that roof. We got up there, and we had, I could not get really close to the edge of anything, but I worked on the peak of the house and kind of brought it down within about 5 feet of the edge, and then Bob had to do all the edge work. I could not get that close to the edge of the roof, and that was just a small roof. But, I mean, it was just a small drop compared to way up there at the peak. But I wasn't afraid up there. I just do not like edges. I don't like edges. I don't like to work on the edge. When we went up to see one time in Washington, we went up to see whenever that volcano erupted, and we were looking over the edge to see the Colorado River and all the damage it did. I could not get out there on the edge to take a look at that even. And I had one little granddaughter, Jenny, that was just like me. I said, God, she's going to be just like me. She's going to follow in my footsteps, because she would get out, she'd get like this and try to get to the edge and see it and just kind of crawl all out there. She never could get to the edge. And I said, there she is. There's one that's like me right there. Could not get to the edge. But all that foundation work is not seen or noticed by anybody. But that is the foundation of your life. That's the foundation of a building, and we are just like buildings. We are temples. We are, God is building something in us, and we all have to be built up to that place where we can receive the things that God has for us in our future. We're not ready to receive them yet. You know, young people think they are just superhuman. They can just do anything. I was one of those. Man, I was like that. I thought I could just do anything. And somebody told me one time, says, Ann, you're not superwoman. You just can't do everything. But I would stay up late at night, get up early in the morning, and man, I had an agenda a mile long the minute my feet hit the floor, and I hit the floor running. And I could not work fast enough and do things long well enough, and I just had this long list in my head of accomplishments that I felt like I had to do. You know, when my grandson was about, he was maybe about 2 years old, he was just barely talking pretty good and barely running very well. And everything, no matter what happened, if something fell to the floor, if the ball ran down the street, or they were playing ball and it ran out in the driveway or something or other, everything was, I'll get it, I'll do it, I'll do it. And we knew he couldn't do it. There was things we knew he could not do. But then if you didn't let him try, he would cry and have a fit. He wanted to do it. And you know, young people don't always know what they still can't do. It takes maturity and walking with God for a long time to get to the place where you realize your limitations. And you know, there was a time in my life whenever I was just very, God has given us a place of refuge, though. God has given us a place of refuge to go to when we get to the place where we get discouraged and we think we cannot go on any further. And I remember a time in my life whenever I had been working at this place that was just really disgusting. The owner was just the most disgusting man I had ever met in my life. And I just didn't know if I could continue working there any longer, but I felt like I really needed to. So on the way home, I stopped at the church to pray. And while I was there praying, and I was just saying, God, I really need your strength. I need your help, Lord, to get through this, to keep going on. And all of a sudden, I had a vision. And I had a vision of myself as a little girl. I believe that's the way God sees us all. He sees us as little children. He said, unless we come to him as a little child, you know, that's what we have to do. We have to come to him like a little child and have faith like a little child. But I saw myself, I was probably looked to be about between 8 and 10 years old or something like that. And I was just sitting there in this little, like, it was not a really cave, but it was like, it was a ledge that came out over this huge rock there. It was like a mountain, and this ledge came out, and I was hiding back there, way back in the back of it, and I was sitting down with my legs folded and my arms around my legs, and I was just feeling so safe and so secure. And after a while, I heard footsteps, and I knew that I was the only one in the building. I had a key, and I had come in. And anybody that came in had to have a key. I didn't hear the door open or anything that sounded like anybody unlocking the door. But I heard these footsteps, and I looked up to see who it was. And it was a man, and it didn't frighten me. But it was a man, and it was just kind of looked a very respectably, nice dressed, in a suit and everything. It looked like a very respectable man, and he was dressed very nicely and everything. But then when he got close to me, he looked at me, and whenever he looked at me, man, I could see such evil through his eyes that it just almost frightened me, the evil. And he looked at me and he said, if you ever get out of your hiding place, I've got you. And the way he said that was, see, it was to intimidate and cause fear. It was try to cause fear in me. But instead of creating fear, you know what? It worked in reverse, because I thought, wow, he can't touch me while I'm in my hiding place. Praise the Lord. And he can't touch you either while you're in that hiding place. And I have a lot of scriptures here to give you. I want to tell you, first of all, we know that our dreams are for a later time. And God has even promised us that in Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the plans that I have for you, saith the Lord, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, but to plans to give you hope and a future. See, that dream is our hope. That dream is what we hope in. We're hoping, and all the time we know we're trusting God, and we know something good is going to happen because we had a dream. Because we have a dream. All right, so these dreams are to give us something to look forward to and bless us at a later time. But at that particular time in my life, I really needed that encouragement of the Lord. I needed that encouragement to know that Satan could not touch me as long as I stayed in that hiding place. So Exodus talks about when God put Moses in the cleft of the rock, which was a protective place. Moses wanted to see God, but no man can see God in the face and live, because he is so bright, and the light is so powerful, and his presence is so powerful that our fleshly body cannot stand it. I do remember a man one time that was telling about an experience that he had with God, that God's presence came in, and he said, man, that presence was so hot and it was so intense and everything that he thought he was going to die. And I think that he just, it felt so intense. And that's the way God is, that if we actually looked on his face, we would not be able to stand it and not be able to live. So in Exodus 33:22, here's what he did. It says, when he told Moses, when my glory passes by, and his glory was his presence passes by, I will put you in a cleft in the rock and cover you with my hand, covered him with his hand until I have passed by. So Moses saw the backside of him but did not see his face. So there are many scriptures that talk about his special, the special hiding place or the safe place. Francis Crosby even wrote a song called He Hideth My Soul. That came to me while I was preparing this, and I thought, God, what a precious song. The chorus goes like this. When I was young, I remember singing this song many times, and I don't need to do the rest of it, but the chorus is what I want to point out. It says, He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock. The shadows that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love and covers me there with his hand. And covers me there with his hand. See, when it said Moses, that they covered him with his hand, that he could not see his face, so he would not perish. So when the enemy comes about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour, which he does, he's always boasting great things. His roar is nothing but a roar. But his roar is meant to cause fear. And we cannot allow fear to ever enter our lives. We have got to be full of faith. We've got to always believe that our God is greater than that. I can hardly wait for the words of this song to come out. This is a brand new song, and I can't hardly wait for these lyrics to come out. I even went on the internet to try to find them and said that they weren't out yet. But I believe that's going to be a powerful song for this day and age right now. And then Psalm 61:3 says, For you are my safe refuge, a fortress where my enemies cannot reach me. Is that powerful or what? My enemies cannot reach me. You are my fortress and my refuge. So as long as we stay in our hiding place, and that hiding place is Jesus Christ, that hiding place, Jesus is the rock. He is that rock, and as long as we stay in that hiding place in him, the enemy cannot touch us. I don't care what he boasts, what he says he'll do, or whatever he says. And there's an enemy right now says all the things that they're planning to do to this society and to this nation. They will not win because our God is greater than that. Amen. All right, Psalm 31:8 in the New Living Translation says, You have not handed me over to my enemies, but have set me in a safe place. God has set us all in a safe place when we trust in him. And Psalm 91:1 says, He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. When we are abiding under the shadow of the Almighty, miracles happen. And we are safe from the enemy. The enemy cannot touch us. And we can defy anything that the enemy comes and tries to tell us. And he is a liar. And we need to, when he comes to you and tries to tell you something that you know is not right, tries to bring condemnation, do you know that the enemy only brings something negative and condemning to our minds? If something like that comes to you, it is not God. God does not condemn us. God only has the good things in store for us. So when the devil comes to try to intimidate you and tell you he's going to do this, that you're going to die from this or you're going to die from that, maybe you've got cancer, maybe you've got something else, we do not have to believe his lies. We do not have to accept his lies. Amen. And then Psalm 32:7 says, Thou art my hiding place. We can hide in him. Thou shalt preserve me from all trouble, and thou shalt compass me about with songs of deliverance. This is one of my morning confessions. Every morning I say that, God, you are my hiding place. You preserve me from all trouble. Thank you, God. Amen. And Psalm 119:14 says, Thou art my hiding place and my shield. He is our protector. He's in front of us. Nothing can pass his shield. Nothing can pass his shield. He is our shield and buckler. The enemy cannot get past that. And I hope in thy word. I hope in thy word. His word gives us hope. His word gives us peace of mind. His hope is our strength. So while we're waiting, God also provides us with special benefits to help us along our pathway to our future. And this is in Psalm 68:19. And this is another one of my daily confessions. God gave me this. These are scriptures that God gave these to me at some point in time in my life. And I try to hang on to those things, and I say them daily. Blessed the Lord who daily loadeth us with benefits. Did you know that every day when you get up in the morning, he has all kinds of benefits ready for you to pour out on you throughout the day? And all we have to do is believe in it and receive them. And he daily, daily loadeth us with benefits. And he thinks of us continually. And he loves us. Tells us we're his sweetheart. Tells us we're his cherished people. His precious people. Our part is to trust God and believe what he has shown us. Believe what he has shown us. Believe in our dreams. Believe in the promises that he's given us, that they will come to pass, because God cannot lie. All we have to do is continue to believe in them and believe every word that he has said to us. So through our dreams, he is teaching us to trust him. And sometimes you may have a dream at night and the Lord will speak to you in that dream. He encourages us along the way. And I always say that, you know, once we get into that place of trust and into that hiding place, it's also like our resting place. Once we have done all that we know to do concerning matter, just put it in his hands and rest. And rest, being assured that he is going to take care of it. Because there's only so much we can do in life. We cannot do everything. Just like my grandson, that I can do it, I can do it, I can do it. There's a lot of things we cannot do. We cannot do without God. God has to do them for us, and we have to be patient and wait upon him to do those things for us. So it might take years sometimes for these things to come to pass, but we have to patiently wait and know that while we are waiting, he is building. He is undergirding us. He is building our foundation. He is preparing us for the future and the things that he has for us. And so he's perfect. He has a perfect time. He knows when our time is right. He knows when the time is right for us to receive the blessing that he has for us. Because he doesn't want us to be arrogant and overconfident and with a proud and a haughty spirit, thinking that we're great and wonderful. We have to come to him with a spirit of humility and forgiveness. Whenever Joseph's dreams came to pass, he had a very humble and forgiving spirit. He forgave all of his brothers. He forgave every single one of them for what they had done to them. And he even turned it around and said, you meant it for evil, but God meant it for good. God had a plan for my life. And God, the evil things that maybe that we feel like happens to us sometimes are part of his plan and part of his realigning our life. Did you know God has to kind of redirect us sometimes to get us to do the things he wants us to do for all of his plans for us to come to pass? Luke 6:48 says, this is a parable that Jesus told. He is like a man which built a house, and he digged deep and laid the foundation on a rock. And when the flood rose and the stream beat vehemently upon the house and could not shake it, for it was founded upon a rock, and that rock is Jesus Christ. If our lives are not founded upon Jesus Christ, the rock of our foundation, then we will fall apart whenever trouble comes. But if our lives are founded upon that rock, we will trust him and say, God, you're in charge of this, and I just trust you. I'm going to just sit here in my hiding place and know that all is well. All is well with my soul. That God, you have my future in your hands. You have my life in your hands. Everything is going to work out for good. So when God gives you a dream, he has to prepare your foundation before he can bring it to pass, and that you will not fail. Because if he prepares that foundation, whenever the storms of life come and trouble comes, you will not fail. You will carry out the things that he has prepared you to do. So first, just like with Joseph, our dreams will come to pass if we continue to trust God, continue daily. It's not a one-time thing. It's a daily, continually trusting God in everything that we do, and wait for him to build our foundation in him. So we have to believe that these things will come to pass, and that I am willing to wait now for God's perfect timing. I know that this thing is about to come to pass in our lives, that God is preparing, and I do believe it's going to happen this year. There's just something in my spirit that tells me that it is, but I am willing to wait. If it doesn't happen this year, I just know it's going to happen in God's perfect timing, and we have to trust him that his timing is always best for us. He knows best. I heard somebody say, remember, Father always knows best. Remember that program on TV, Father Knows Best? Well, our Father absolutely always knows best. So there's a lot of foundation preparation that God wants to build in our lives. so we can fulfill his plan that he has for us and our purpose. He has a purpose and plan for us. I don't know if I brought out last week or the week before, but did you know that even every one of our parts and our members of our body are all written in a book? Not only our purpose and our plan for our life, but every bit of our members, all of our members are written in there. So even when disease and affliction comes, God has built it. He has a trophy room of all of the parts that he can just call forth just like that. We need to believe that and trust him for those things. You know, we're entering a time, I believe, of a great spiritual awakening. And this awakening, we have to, is part of the things that he's preparing us for right now. We have to get this foundation in us and realize that we have got to trust him because there are great things ahead. He has great plans for his church and for his body, things that we know not of yet. He can't even tell us of those things because we can't imagine them yet. All the things that he has prepared for us are beyond our greatest imagination. And there's a scripture for that that says that it's written that all these things that eyes have not seen, ears have not heard, neither is it written all the things that God has planned for his people that are ahead. It's not even in our imagination. It's just like heaven. We can't even imagine, really. We hear good things about heaven, the people that have gone there, but we really don't know and can't even begin to comprehend the real reality of what heaven is like. We can't comprehend it because we haven't seen it yet. And even when we see it, I don't even know if we'll be able to comprehend or take it all in right away. It'll take us probably all of eternity to really realize how great heaven is. So have you noticed that before a building goes up, there's a lot of dirt has to be moved. There's a lot of foundational work that has to be done. All the underground work, these are things that people can't see. God is also doing an inner work in you that outwardly people can't see. But God is working in you, perfecting you, and bringing you to the place that he can do great things for you and also bring you to that place of your purpose in your life. And it takes all this inner work. This inner work sometimes takes years. It all depends, a lot of it depends on us. How close we walk with God, how close we try to live our lives, that we have to live our lives so close to God and just trust him to do all things well for us. And it's not always easy to do that. We battle the flesh every day. We battle the desires of the flesh. The desires of the flesh wants to lead us astray, wants to lead us in another direction. But God has a perfect direction for us. And we're only going to live a part time or just a temporary time in this world. But we're going to live in eternity forever. So we want our foundation built so that we achieve the great purpose that God has for us. And that is eternal life with him forever and ever and ever. That is our greatest hope and our greatest direction. So when this foundation is being built, there's a lot of underground work being done. Nobody can see it. Nobody knows even a building is going up. But Bob and I, from building our house, we know when we see people starting to shovel dirt and move things around, we say, I wonder what they're going to build there. You know, because we know that's the first step to building a building is moving dirt. Praise God. So in our lives, God is doing a lot of inner work. And we have to be prepared for that. We have to trust him to do it and trust him that he will complete the job in us that he has begun. Soon the walls start going up. And once the wall's going up, then all of a sudden other people can begin to see. You know, I know there's a woman in our church that I have noticed over the last month or so, a difference about something different about her countenance. And I told her that this morning. I said, you know, I have really noticed that there's something different about you. God is doing something different in your life, that he's brought you up a step higher. He said, oh yes, he has. He says, God has just been moving mightily. You know, it shows in a person's face when God is really moving in their life. It shows on the outwardly that God is doing an inner work. And that inner work has to begin before the foundation can be completed. So soon the walls start going up and the whole world can then see it. And in our lives, as God begins to do this work in us, first thing you know, our lives begin to change. People begin to notice, hey, God is doing something special in that person's life. I can see it. I can see it in their countenance. I can see it in the things they do and the way they talk. Man, I hate complaining. I hate complaining. And you know what? When we complain about our circumstances, God turns a deaf ear to the things we're saying. He doesn't hear anything like that. He hears his word. He hears things when we are repeating his word. God is hearing us. God hears and recognizes his word. So we need to start professing and claiming his word in our lives, the things that he's doing in our life and the things that he's promised us in our lives, because that is the thing that God is going to answer, and that's the thing that he's going to promise. So in our lives, after a certain point, that inner transformation, others begin to see it. And that's the transformation that we all need. We are looking for that transformation to come to pass and our building to be complete. And the Holy Spirit, this is the building, this is a temple of the living God, that he dwells in us as is in us. I heard David Jeremiah say the Lord. Did you know that the Holy Spirit's first name is Holy? Wow, when you think of that, God's Spirit is in us. That means it's the Holy Spirit that's in us. And that Holy Spirit should be making us holy. So there should be a great transformation there, that all of a sudden our old things start passing away. The things that we said and did before, they start passing away. Our conversation is very important. And that inner work that he's doing in us will transform our conversation. We'll no longer say the ugly words we said before. We'll no longer complain and become bitter about things. But we'll begin to learn to talk like God talks. We'll begin to learn to talk about his promises and what he's doing in our life and the great and wondrous things he's doing. And God hears our every thought. Did you know he hears every conversation that you have? He hears and knows even your thoughts and your contemplation, the things that you think about doing even before you ever do them. He knows it all. He knows it all. Can't hide anything from God. And so whenever I pray, I learned to just pray very simplistic whenever I was a young Christian, and I still do, because you might as well be just very plain and open with God, because he knows your thoughts anyway. He knows everything anyway. So just, you don't have to say fancy words when you're talking to God. Did you know that the Bible is so easy to understand? There's no really long or complicated words in it. Every word in the Bible is something easy that even a grade school child should be able to comprehend and understand it. It's written in very plain terms. Now, maybe the King James Version is not plain only because it was designed by King James. And that's the way they talked back in those days. But now the newer translations that come out are very plain and simple. Right now I'm reading the New Living Translation, and I really do like it because it is so plain. It just says it like it is, and I love it. And it's not hard to understand. There's no old English in it or anything, but I was raised on the King James Version. I was saved reading the King James Version, and for many years of my life, that was the only version I thought that you were supposed to ever read. I almost thought it was a crime to read some other version, that it was changing something. But you know what? It's all right. A lot of times I read different versions to get a clearer picture of what the whole meaning of something is, and it helps us very much. So it's okay to read another version. And I like to know what some of these other versions say, because sometimes they clarify things. But you can be saved by reading just the King James Version. It's clear enough, even though it's written in King James, you can still understand it well enough. So our foundation, it may take years to complete. And a lot of it depends on us. Some foundations are built faster than others. It depends on all the work that we want to put into it, and try to get our, to help God in working on our foundation and trusting him and learning to lean on him more. But when we start going and doing things our own way, sometimes we get in trouble. And you know, even the best of people in the Bible, even Abraham, was a man after God's own heart. He was a man of faith. He was the foundation of faith. He's the one that we always think of when we think about faith. But even he, there was a time when he even wavered a little bit in faith. God had promised him a son, he and Sarah, a son. And it never happened, and it never happened, and it never happened. And finally, they were getting way up there in years. He was around 90 years old or so, or maybe not quite that old. But they suddenly decided, okay, God, we're going to have to help you. Don't ever think you have to help God. Never think you have to help God. Whenever you do, you're going to get in trouble. You get in trouble every time. But he thought, well, we're going to help you, God. And it says, so Sarah says, go into my handmaid here, Hagar, and have a child with her, and he'll be the promised child. Well, they did. And then Ishmael was born. You know that because of that, Ishmael still is a problem to Christianity to this day. Is a problem. But it wasn't Ishmael's fault that he was born. Think of that. It was not Ishmael's fault. It was Abraham and Sarah's fault. And Sarah actually was one that suggested it. So maybe I thought, all right, God, maybe this is your plan. Don't try to outthink God. Don't try to come up with another plan. When things don't start to happen like you think they should, don't try to devise your own plan, devise your own way, and think God needs some help. God, I think that this is probably what you should do. No, never, 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 never. And because of that, though, Ishmael was born, but God honored Ishmael even. You know, God loves us all. And it wasn't Ishmael's fault that he was born. And God blessed Ishmael. And he made of him a great nation as well. And he loved Ishmael. God loves everyone out there today. He loves the sinner, and he loves the righteous, and he loves all of mankind. When he died for all of mankind. And you know, this morning, I think it was so great how that Pastor Randy brought out how that we are supposed to pray against these principalities and powers. And it's very easy sometimes when we see people doing wicked things that we might start wanting to come against them. But it's the demons that are driving those people to do the things that they're doing. It's the demons that we need to come against and to overcome. We need to, and God has given us the victory over it. And because God gave us the victory, just the other day, whenever I was praying, I said, God, it was because of your victory on the cross that you conquered and gained back dominion for us right now. And we now have dominion over Satan and all of these principalities and powers. It's no longer like it was in the Garden of Eden when they lost their dominion. We now have dominion over all these things. They're all under our feet. They're under our feet. Do not listen to the devil's lies. Do not listen to him whenever he starts getting arrogant and saying all the things he's going to do, because God's going to bring him down in a moment. And he has the keys of death, hell, and the grave. He has all these keys, and in the end, Satan is going to be cast into that lake of fire along with all his angels and all of those evil ones, the false prophet, all of those that have tried to deceive the nations, all of those that have tried to deceive his people, deceive mankind, and he is not going to win. He is not. We already know the end of the story. Praise God. We know the end, and I'm so glad God gave us that end. So Psalm 5:12 says, "For you, O Lord, will bless the righteous with favor. You will surround him as with a shield." That shield surrounds us. You know, it says the angel of the Lord encamps all around his people. That's our shield. That's our shield. He sends his ministering angels to encamp and to help his people. And they are the ministers of mankind, those that will inherit eternal life. And this righteousness, he blesses the righteous. A lot of people don't like to call themselves righteous, but God called us righteous. When we are born again, we are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. As long as we're in Christ Jesus, we are his righteous. Thank God. Praise the Lord. Proverbs 3:1-4 says, "My son, do not forget my law, but let your heart keep my commands. Length of days and long life and peace will they add to you. Let not mercy and truth forsake you. Bind them on your neck, write them on the table of your heart, and so find favor and high esteem in the sight of God and man." You know, when we do his will and when we try to obey his commandments and we regard him highly and we trust him, we find favor in his sight. Favor, great favor, and he will show great favor to the righteous, to those that walk uprightly before him and that try to do everything right. Does that mean we're perfect? No, we're never perfect. You know, I've had to actually, even from the time that I was saved, a lot of my theology has changed through the years because I've learned more things, and God knows where we are. He knows what our learning is, what our knowledge is, and we're judged a lot by the things that we know. To him that knoweth to do good, and to doeth it not, to him it is sin. So maybe the very thing that he did is not sin to somebody else, because that person didn't know any better. You see what I mean? So we all change from day to day because we're changing from glory to glory. And it's his glory and power in us that's changing us. That inner man is constantly being transformed to be able to obtain the greater favor and the greater blessings that God has for us. So some of you might be going through some very difficult times, but God knows it. He's not blind to it, and he's never forgotten you. Just remember that. He hasn't forgotten you. And some of those difficult times you're going through might be a period of realignment in your life, that God is trying to realign you for greater things in the future. So perhaps you've lost your job. Maybe you don't know where you're going from here, but God knows, and he has something good in store for you. Believe that. Always believe that God has something good in store for you. That scripture says, I know the plans that I have for you, saith the Lord, to prosper you and not to harm you. So all these things God has in store for us, we need to keep professing these things. Never profess that God has forgotten me and that he does not exist. You know, people sometimes become bitter because hardships happen in their life. We cannot allow that. That is exactly what the enemy wants us to do. That's what the devil wants us to do, is to give up and feel sorry for ourselves and think that nothing good is ever going to happen in my life, because it's not true. If you continue to trust God and put your trust in him, only good things will happen in your life. And if when we think things are not good, they could be that God is trying to do this to prepare something better for you. So you need to realize that sometimes that all things that seem to appear to be not good are actually God realigning things in your life in order to prepare a better future for you. Proverbs 8:35 says, "Whoso findeth me findeth life, and shall obtain favor of the Lord." When we find God, we find life. Life in him. And that life is eternal life. And it will never pass away. And we find favor of the Lord. When God favors you, you can do anything. You can do anything. You can do all things in Christ, for he strengthens you. And the favor of God in your life will absolutely transform you and help you to maintain and keep your dreams, and those dreams be fulfilled in your life. Proverbs 12:2 says, "A good man obtaineth favor of the Lord, but a man of wicked devices will he condemn." People that are wicked, God will condemn them, and they will be convicted. I always say, God, let the Holy Spirit guide my pathway and direct me in the pathway that you would have me to go, Lord. I only want favor of God in my life. I do not want anything evil. And we can just believe that when something happens that is not something that we feel like should have happened, we can just say, God, I know this is all part of your plan. I trust you that you're going to bring me out of this, that everything is going to go well from here, because he will bring a good out of those things that seem bad sometimes. He'll bring good out of it if we trust him too. So how many times do you begin to get impatient because things are not going the way you think they should? And the wicked sometimes seem to be getting more favor and getting richer and wealthier and everything going better for them than for you, and has God forgotten you? I have felt that way at times in my life. I've wondered, God, look at all these people. They're just getting away with murder. They're doing all this junk that they shouldn't be doing, and they're getting away with it. Where are you, God? Where are you? Where are you? Where are you? Sometimes, you know, it's tempting for us to begin to think like that, but God knows what's happening. He's not blind. He knows exactly what's going on. And all of these things, he's repositioning and realigning in the world and realigning in our nation and realigning in our lives. And he's setting things up for greater things ahead. Believe that, trust him for it, and you will see great and wondrous things happen in your life and your future. In Jesus' name. Father, I thank you, God, for your promises, Lord, that are yes and amen. They will come to pass, Lord, for if you have said it, Lord, God, it is done. I believe it. If you said it, I believe it, and we know that it will come to pass. And we pray, God, for everyone here in the hearing of these words tonight, Lord, God, to be mightily blessed. Let your great favor come upon them, Lord, and let them rejoice in you and remain in that hiding place all the days of their life, Lord God, that the enemy cannot touch them, cannot destroy their lives, Lord, for God, you have greater plans for us. In Jesus' holy name, thank you, Lord. Amen.